In this lecture, we're going to continue with more malware, and we start out by looking at worms. And here, really, the key word for worms is they're self-propagating. Remember, this is an English exam. Self-propagating really just means that it can spread on its own. It doesn't need any help, it doesn't need any human interaction. The worm contains both the payload damage, which is whatever it's designed to do on our systems, but it also contains a part that's going to make it replicate aggressively throughout our network. It doesn't just want to infect one system, it wants to infect as many as possible. But then that aggressive self-propagation also makes it much, much easier to spot. And here we should probably talk a little bit about the different types of antivirus and intrusion detection and intrusion prevention systems, because they're built on the same things. So when we just talked about that a virus has a signature, the antivirus has all those signatures in a large database, and the only thing that part of the antivirus does is that it looks for things that matches those signatures. But here it's important that anything that uses a signature has to be updated all the time, because there can be hundreds or thousands of new signatures every day. The other part of the antivirus is called heuristic or behavioral based, and that part of the system looks for abnormal behavior. If all of a sudden we see a ton of networking traffic, that could be a worm spreading, because it wants to do that aggressive self-propagation. If all of a sudden one of our systems sends a bunch of email traffic out and it's not an email server, well, maybe someone compromised it and it's being used as a bot in a botnet. So we need both the signatures and we need the behavioral-based systems. Antivirus has both. And we are going to cover these more in depth later, but it makes sense to talk about it a little bit here, since we are talking about virus signatures. Next up, we have Trojans. If you remember the story of the Trojan horse, it kind of makes sense. The Trojan horse had the malicious payload hidden inside. This is exactly the same thing. Here, you go to a website or an attachment or a program that looks like the real thing, but then inside there's the malicious code. That can be you going to a website and clicking on a thing you know you probably shouldn't. Downloading a file from somewhere. If either of those are infected, or you click on an email attachment. Whenever you open that file, you are going to see the actual real file. But on top of that, your system is also going to get infected. And here again, we need that mix of technical and administrative controls. Technical, we look for those things, we look for the signatures, we look for the attachments that look wrong, we block the websites that could have malicious traffic, and then administrative, we give the users the training, we raise their awareness, we change their behavior. They know not to click on that link. One of the types of Trojans we're seeing more of now is RATS, Remote Access Trojan. And here, the Trojan gives the attacker admin access over whatever system they are infecting. Alright, let's recap. In this lecture, we talked about hackers. They used to be someone who would find unique ways of using something for something it was not intended for. But now the use is more someone who's trying to gain access to or disrupt any link of the CIA triad. That is our confidentiality, integrity, and availability. The hackers range from white hat to black hat hackers. White hat are ethical hackers. These are the people who are trying to find the flaws so we can protect our systems. On the other side of the spectrum, black hats, they're also trying to find the flaws, but for entirely different reasons. These are the attackers. And then in the middle there, there's a spectrum of gray hat hackers. They're also trying to find the flaws, but they won't exploit them. They will either tell the company, you have a problem, please fix it, or we're going to publish it, or they're just going to publish it. The downside here is, as soon as they publish that flaw, all the attackers know it's there, and the company doesn't have time to prepare a patch. And then we have the term script kiddie. You can download some amazingly dangerous tools online today, you can do an incredible amount of damage, and it doesn't really require a lot of skill. Those are script kiddies. Then we talked about how there are many more external threats, but because of our layered defense, a lot of times they're not going to be as effective, whereas with the internal threats, because they have gotten through our outside layered defense, regardless if it's malicious or not, they're still going to have a higher chance of succeeding. We looked at lost or improper disposal of data was 6%, internal theft is 8%, employee actions or mistakes 24%, and all of those, to some extent, can be minimized with proper training and education. Then we have vendors, 14%, external theft, 17%, malware, hacking, and phishing, 31%, and some of that can also be mitigated by raising the awareness of our internal employees, but a lot of what we need to do here is also technical. We talked about hacktivism and state-sponsored hacking. Hacktivism is for a cause, something they believe in, really depends on your values and your opinions. Then we had state-sponsored hacking. This is a 9-to-5 job in more than 120 countries in the world, and many of the countries that doesn't have that, it's not because they don't want to, it's because they don't have the capacity. We talked a little bit about bots and botnets. The bot or the zombie is the individual infected computer, then above that we would have the bot herder, and that could have 10,000 zombies. Above that, that could be another herder and another herder. So sometimes botnets can be in the millions. They're run through a CNC network, command and control, and normally the attacker would go through multiple secure links before they actually get to the first bot herder. The more degrees of separation, the less likely it is that the attacker is going to get caught. Then we talked about malware, and that's really the catch-all name for any malicious software that's used to compromise our systems or our data. We talked about viruses. They have to have some sort of human interaction. We talked about macroviruses. They're embedded in a document, Word, Excel, PDF, whatever. Once you click on that attachment, you open the real attachment, but when the macros run, your system gets infected. Then we talked about boot sector viruses. If we look at a regular PC, it has two operating systems. It has the lower level operating system, the BIOS, that starts before the operating system you see. If you can infect that, well, even if you clean the regular operating system, it's still going to reinfect every time you start the computer. Then we talked about stealth viruses. They're trying to hide themselves from our antivirus software and from our operating systems. We talked about polymorphic viruses. They're changing their signature, trying again to avoid detection from our antivirus. And then we talked about multi-part viruses. They spread across multiple vectors. If they're in three places and we clean them in two, at some point it's going to replicate out to the other two locations again. Then we talked about how antivirus software can be signature-based and behavioral-based or heuristic. Any antivirus now is going to be both. The signature-based looks for all the known malware signatures that we have. They are in the millions. And the heuristic or the behavioral-based system looks for any abnormal behavior on our system, anything that's not normal. But that can also lead to a lot of false positives. Then we talked about worms, how they spread through self-propagation, meaning they don't need any human interaction. They have both the payload that's going to do the actual damage to our systems, and then they have the part that's going to replicate as much as they can throughout our entire network, which also makes them easier to spot. And then we talked about Trojans. Just like the Trojan horse, the malicious payload is hidden. That could be you downloading a game. You get the real game, but within that game, there's also the malware. And then finally, we talked about remote access Trojans. They're just regular Trojans, but once they have infected the system, the attacker has admin access. And with that, we are done with attackers and attacks. I hope this has helped you get a little bit of a better understanding of the different attacks that we face and the countermeasures we can use against them. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.